It's good to see you. Good to see you. Whether you're here in the house or if you're watching from your house or tuning in a little bit later, I want to say thank you for joining us, making Northfield Church a part of your week. Our mission here at Northfield is simple. Our mission is to love God, to love people, and make Jesus known. That's why we exist as a church family. It's why we gather together and worship. It's why we stream our services so that you can be a part of these moments, is to make that name of Jesus known in everything that we do. So I got a couple opportunities for you, especially those of you in the room who have kids, especially some young kids, two opportunities that are coming up in this Christmas season to help you. One is really a family worship experience that's coming up. We are throwing a birthday bash for Jesus. And so on December 11th, we're gathering right here on campus. You got to pre-register for this event, but you're going to have a chance to make a nativity set, like a little, add a little gingerbread houses. There's going to be a photo op. You get breakfast to be a part of that. And so again, it'd be a great family worship experience for you and your family to be a part of. Go to northfieldchurch.net/event and you can find the sign up link for that. We just added a new time this morning, so there's another time slot that's available. So if you're like, hey, I went and it was full, not anymore. We added some more space for you guys. And then also on December the 18th coming up, if you have seen or if you've not seen the animated movie called The Star, it is an adorable movie that you and your family can go be a part of. We have rented out the Palace Theater up in Gallatin. And so for $5, you and your family, you can go up there and you can watch this movie. And even better, the proceeds that come from that movie are actually going straight towards Night to Shine. So not only do you get a great family moment, but you also get to support an incredible cause that's happening on our campus in February, that is Night to Shine, which is a prom experience for people with special needs right here in our community. And so two options that you can be a part of, go to northfieldchurch.net/events, and you can find some ways to jump in and be a part of those. Also, I want to invite you to check in on Facebook or Instagram. It's the last Sunday of November. Can you believe it? Like, it is beginning to look a lot like Christmas everywhere that you go. There you go. And that was supposed to be funny. I'm so sorry. That was that. Thank you, John. I appreciate that. No drum roll. Thanks, Travis. Like, cool. I got myself lost there. What were we talking about? Don't forget to check in on Facebook or Instagram so you can do a little bit of good through an organization called Feed One. You can be a part of providing some meals for kids just by using your social media accounts for a little bit of good. So check in and do good this morning. I'm going to turn it over to this crew here. We're going to sing a little bit this morning. We're kicking off a brand new Christmas season called Countdown to Christmas. I hope that you're excited about being a part of that. But y'all go ahead and get on your feet. We're going to sing out. Thanks for being here.
You've been walking the same old road for miles and miles. You've been hearing the same old voice tell the same old lies. You've been trying to fill the same old holes inside. There's a better life. There's a better life. If you got pain, he's a pain taker. We've all searched for the light of day, dead of night. We've all found ourselves worn out from the same old fight. We've all run to things we know just ain't right. And there's a better life. There's a better life. You got pain. Feel it, somebody testify. If you believe it, you receive it. You believe it, you receive it. You can feel it.
ready for a miracle in their lives, sing this out with us.
The weapon may be formed, but it won't prosper. When the darkness falls, it won't prevail. 'Cause the God I serve knows only how to triumph. My God will never fail. My God will never fail. I'm gonna see a victory. I'm gonna see a victory. For the battle belongs to you, Lord. I'm gonna see a victory. I'm gonna see a victory. For the battle belongs to you, Lord.
You guys sound great. Sing this out. There's power in the mighty name of Jesus.
There's power in the mighty name of Jesus. Every war he wages, he will.
Out with us. You take
what the enemy meant for evil, and you turn it for good. You turn it for good. You take what the enemy meant for evil, and you turn it for good. You turn it for good. You take what the enemy meant for evil, and you turn it for good. You turn it for good, yes, you do, Lord. You take what the enemy meant for evil, and you turn it for good. You turn it for good.
Jesus, that's amazing. Shout it out. You take
what the enemy meant.
We're so glad you all are here with us this morning. We hope you had a great Thanksgiving. We want to welcome you to the Father's house this morning to sing this out with us. Sometimes on this journey, I get lost in my mistakes. What looks to me like weakness is a canvas for your strength. My story isn't over. My story's just begun. Fail, you won't define me, 'cause that's what my Father does, yeah. Fail, you won't define me, 'cause that's what my Father does. Ooh, lay your burdens down. Ooh, here in the Father's house, check your shame at the door. City welcome anymore. Ooh, you're in the Father's house. Let me hear you. Rivals, not the end game. Rivals, not the end game. The journey's where you are. You never want it perfect. This one in my heart. And the story isn't over if the story isn't good. And failure's never final when the Father's in the room. No, failure's never final. Prodigals come home. Prodigals come home. The helpless find home. Love is on the move when the Father's in the room. Prison doors fling wide. The dead come to life. Love is on the move when the Father's in the room. Miracles. Miracles take place. The cynical find aid. Love is breaking through when the Father's in the room. Jericho walls are quaking. Strongholds now are shaking. Love is breaking through when the Father's in the room. Love is breaking through when the Father's in the room.
Hey guys, we're going to go into a time of communion, and so if you want to have a seat, that would be awesome. If you did not get a chance to grab a cup of communion on the way in, there's going to be some folks coming down the aisle right now. You can raise your hand. They would love to get you one of those. And hey, if you're watching with us from home or maybe you're on vacation, hey, we would love for you to hit pause, go grab some supplies, come back, and let's worship together through communion. Well, guys, I've been thinking a lot about the Christmas story, right? We just got through Thanksgiving, and this season, it feels like we can barely breathe sometimes, right? And I think that's probably just from how much I ate at Thanksgiving. There's not as much room. But, you know, in thinking through, like, Christmas is coming and thinking through the Christmas story, I began to think just how unlikely the Christmas story is. Well, there's a lot of unlikelies. Like, we can take the big unlikely out of what we're going to talk about today. I mean, the big one, obviously, is that the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords came down here and was born in front of a bunch of animals, right? That's the probably the most ironic part. But the thing that I've thought about today is, like, can we just, like, talk about the shepherds for a minute? Like, you're sitting on a hillside watching some sheep, and all of a sudden, out of nowhere, here come these angels, right? They're praising God. They're saying, glory to God in the highest, and they announce his birth, and it's this grand entrance to really a not-so-grand audience. I mean, shepherds, like, the angels didn't appear to the political powers of that day. It didn't appear to the religious leaders of that day. It appeared to the lowliest of shepherds, sitting on the side of a hill, just hanging out. And then all of a sudden, they're surrounded by the glory of God. And so that gives me great hope today. Because, see, that wasn't just a moment in that story that he was singling out this group of people. I think what he was trying to communicate to us on a larger scale was that's what Jesus came to do. He didn't come for the people that had it all together. He didn't come for the people that looked great or had wealth or had power. He came for those that were normal, just like me and you. He came to die for each and every one of us. But he didn't just come for the people that had the look down, that had it all together. He came to people watching sheep. And so today, man, that's cause for celebration for us. You see, because where the story began with a birth, it ended in a death. And so today, we don't just celebrate the Christmas season because it's warm and fuzzy and because we get gifts and Santa and all that stuff. We celebrate today that baby was born in a manger, very ironically, in the lowliest of low. We celebrate the day that he came, but also the day that he died, and especially the day he rose again. So this morning, you're holding in your hands, yes, we're celebrating his death. But today, as we think through communion, maybe we picture, as we take the bread, that maybe it doesn't just symbolize his body crucified, but maybe it's just his body born. Born in a place that it says he stepped out of the splendor and the glory of heaven to come right here for me and for you. Like, let's celebrate that today. So as we peel back this top layer, you'll find the bread there. And as we take it, we celebrate Jesus who came here, stepped out of heaven, and put on flesh for us. And as you peel back that next layer, you'll find the cup there, the juice, which, as we say every single week, the juice itself has no special thing about it. But what it symbolizes was his blood spilled out for you and for me, for all of our sins. And so today, Jesus, we just proclaim that we're grateful. Lord, that you didn't just come to the people that had it all together. You didn't come to the ones who had power and influence and could spread your name immediately. You showed up on the side of a hill. Your angels show up with all of their splendor, all of their majesty, and they show up with people that no one would have expected. And Jesus, we thank you that your invitation then is the same as it is now. It's come and see what God has done. Come to Bethlehem and see this baby born. But even now, Jesus, you beckon us to the least of us. Come and see what I can do. And so as we go into this season of Christmas and we go into this season of celebration, may we remember that this season is all about coming and seeing what you're getting ready to do. Let's worship together, guys.
Unto us a child is born. Upon his shoulders, and he will be called Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, and Prince of Peace.
Father, I thank you. I thank you that you are a good God. Father, I thank you for being the light of the world. Father, it is for you that that our entire world, it seems, turns its thoughts to you this time of year. I pray, Father, that we will continue to be a people who carry that light into bigger and greater things. And that, Father, I pray that we will always be a people who are thankful for the amazing love that you showed us. Father, we came to hear from you, so I ask you to speak through the words of our time together today, through the words of our message, just as you have spoken through the words of these songs. And I ask it in the name of Jesus, and the entire church at Northfield said, amen. Well, hey, you may be seated. I want to echo Trent's words of welcome to those of you who are with us today in the house, and to those of you who are viewing online today, welcome. To those of you who are traveling and are in your car at this very moment because you're coming back from a Thanksgiving trip, I want to thank you for tuning in this morning as well. Hope everyone had a great Thanksgiving day, a great Saturday, which I understood was like small business buying day, a Black Friday, a Cyber Monday, a Giving Tuesday, so many things in this season just to be thankful for. And speaking of giving, I hope that each of you are prayerfully considering what God has for you and for us through this time when we're looking at moving forward in our greater vision. If you were with us last week, you know that we laid out several opportunities that I think are before us. Those opportunities are summarized on the back of the November news, which Lisa's put together for us. You can pick those up at any of the doors on the way out if you did not get one on the way in. And it has all the different things that our funds for the end of this year are going to go for. We're praying the prayer of Habakkuk and Habakkuk 3 verse 2. It was really, you know, Habakkuk was a prophet. He's looking at the nation of Israel. And he has this prayer about this coming Messiah, this coming goodness of God. And he says these words, Lord, I have heard the news about you, which meant somebody was talking about what God had done. He says, I'm amazed at what you have done. And then he, as he reflects on the past and the goodness of God from the past, he looks towards the future and he says, Lord, would you do great things once again in our time? And I love this thought. Would you make those things happen again in our own days? And that is our prayer moving forward. And we do believe that the next few years at Northville are going to be exciting and they're going to be formative years in the life of our church family. And as we prayed and as we planned, there are several big things on the horizon. If you've been around, we told you about them last week. We would love to expand this, and I don't think it's going back. I think it's going to two services that are big enough for all of us to be in at one time and have room to grow. We're looking at our children's areas. What do we need to do there to accommodate more kids and growing to our growing children's ministry? And then even looking at starting a weekly preschool where you would meet every day of the week in there. All of those things I think are exciting. And we are believing and claiming what Paul said in Ephesians 3:20. Now unto him who is able to do immeasurably more than all we ask or imagine. So when you think about the goal that we laid out for you, which was to raise $1 million by the end of the year, we're thinking that is just a starting place, that when we put a challenge out there, that God will move through us and teach us how to be God in our community and in our world and right here at our home. Just very quickly over the next three and a half minutes to bring you up on what we said last week. We're trying to raise that $1 million for this. The first is the Sumner Center. To completely go ahead and raise and have all of that behind us, what it takes to operate the Sumner Center, from the food bags to the for the homeless, to the food boxes that go out on a monthly basis, to the supplies we're going to need for dental days, for computers, for our job skills lab and resume training, and just for the ongoing operations, to have that completely funded. That's our community out there that we want to be a part of. The second thing we said we wanted to go to, 50,000 of that, we wanted to be one of the first churches to come online and say, you know what? We want to be a part of what Habitat Humanity is doing right here in our community. They have put a goal out there to build 49 new homes in the Gallatin area, two subdivisions, which is an exciting and thing that Habitat for Humanity is trying to do, and we want to be a part of that. For $50,000, we can sponsor one of those homes, and we can see someone go from struggling to have a home to where they could afford and make a payment in that home as well. We also said we wanted to bless our world through Hope Springs. Hope Springs is an organization that brings lasting change to three countries in Africa, the countries of Chad, the country of Nigeria, and the country of Niger. They are based right here in our own building in our Northville campus. What we said we would like to do is, one, build a school building that will have two classrooms in it, something that looks a little bit like this, but will enable us to have not this many children in one classroom, but be able to teach them better. We told you last week we have over 1,100 children in that school now, and it is the only school that we can find in that area of the world who teaches both English and Bible to children. We also said we want to dig six additional wells so that people wouldn't have to drink water that looks like that, and bring clean water to over 6,000 people. We wanted to provide the funds for Lee Hodges and our bass player, John Harris, to make it back to Africa again in 2022 to look at how we could expand those things. Again, that's going to take about $50,000. We also said we would like to update the internet and security system around our building. That's to our Northville facility here. What that will enable us to do is, if you watch online, sometimes there are little blips, sometimes there are little pauses because we're not everything we need to be, and we would like to take what's happening in this building to upgrade it, but expand it to our entire campus through our security system, through the door, so that if you teach a small group or if you have a basketball, something that's meeting in the gym where we can give you a key and you can get in or out with that. It would also provide greater streaming services so that we could stream not just locally here, but almost anywhere the network would go, and provide a way to simulcast events. Like if you're familiar with Priscilla Shire, every year that she'll have an event that simulcasts throughout the entire country, and we can be one of those churches that would support and sponsor one of those events, whether it's for women or whether it's for men. As you can imagine, those type of things are not cheap. Comes at a cost of $235,000, but it will enable us to go into the next phase of what we want to do. We also wanted to bless our community and our Northville home, especially our members of people who have special needs in their families, by an all-inclusive playground. It would start out an initial drawing like this, but we already have a team of people who are going to get together and begin to modify what that's going to look like. It will enable us to further expand what we're doing through Embraced and Gigi's Playhouse and several things like that. I think in providing all of us a place where we could have small group meetings and the weather is great through the spring, the summer, and the fall, our children could play on that playground there. If you've not been to the back and looked at the student area, there are two Gaga pits that are already back there thanks to Garrett Brothers Concrete and some wonderful guys from our own Northville family who put those things together. And one of those that first went up there on the hill is already handicap accessible, so that our students who are in wheelchair bound can go in there and play in those things as well. One of the things that I did not mention last week was those last two things of having an updated security system and having a playground that would be all inclusive. We have to have that in place before we can move ahead with having a daily preschool in the building. So that's one of the things that will have to be done before we can move ahead with that. And we're looking and already talking to people about providing one of the only biblically based STEAM curriculums for preschool in the entire Sumner County area. And we're already talking about a company and making that happen. So all of that kind of goes together. The last thing we talked about last week was global missions. Several of you are already in organizations that that reach out in places around the world, and we wanted to come in and be able to play a small part in what you are doing. All of those came to $1 million, which seemed like a lot of money, but when we broke it down and started telling people about our vision, Sue Noakes, who spoke to us last week, came to us with a generous matching grant from the Susan G. Noakes Foundation, where she has agreed to match $500,000, dollar for dollar. So we raised $500,000, we're already at $1 million. And can y'all give me a drum roll from last week? We're 1 week in. Yeah, I see a drum roll going there. Oh, we are at, here we go, $118,502 after the very first week, which, yeah, you can clap for that. Which, when you match that, brings us over 25% of the way to the goal for the whole season, $237,004. But again, that $1 million is just a starting place to be able to do a lot of things out there. Sue said last week, she said, I think we can do more. She said, you know, I think that if we would just look at what God is doing and we would pray about it, that God would lead us. And she said, I'm going to pray that prayer in Ephesians 3:20 that God would do immeasurably more than all we could ask or even imagine. Well, if you want to know how to give, again, which I didn't even get to last week, it's on the back of this brochure. There are four ways that you can give to be a part of this campaign. On any of those four ways, just mark greater vision on there, and it will go directly to the things that you have listed up here. And what we raise above and beyond that $1 million is going to go to an account to start looking at what we can do building-wise when these things that have to be done before we can do that are in place. You can give in person on the boxes on the way out. You can give through text, you can give online, and you can also give by snail mail, again, by just putting a check in an envelope and putting a stamp on it and finding a post office and going to there. All of those will work. Several have asked if you could pledge. Yes, you can pledge throughout the course of the year. That would be great. I'm even meeting with a family in the morning who said, you know what, we're ready to do our 3-year plan with their whole family. So they're coming in to see what they can do over the next 3 years. So I'm excited. Each week as we go out this series, we're going to try to update you on where we are leading up to Christmas Eve in that wonderful service. If you have any questions, contact Lisa, lisa@northfieldchurch.net, and she will get you in touch with, if she doesn't know the answer, she'll get you in touch with someone who does, and we'll set aside together to talk. Well, today, I'm excited to tell you that we are launching our Christmas series. We're calling it Countdown to Christmas, Countdown to Christmas. And I am as excited about this Christmas series as I have been in any of the 12 Christmas series that I have done since changing my former job from being an accountant to being a pastor. I can't believe I got 12 Christmas seasons behind me. But there's going to be one big change in this Christmas season that hasn't happened in any of the 12 previous Christmas series. And that change is going to be in who is leading that Christmas series. Many of you know that my wife and I spent the first 2 years of our marriage on the island of Oahu in Hawaii as student ministers. Well, 2 years ago, we had planned to go back for our 35th wedding anniversary. I know I do not look like I'm old enough to be married 35 years, but believe me, I am. When they zoom in on the camera, you can see that I am there. But we were married 35 years 2 years ago, and as that time in December rolled around, December 29th, I was diagnosed with prostate cancer. Many of you know I had surgery. And so the airlines and the hotels were so gracious in fast-forwarding all of that a year. They said, well, we'll just take what's in place. We'll fast-forward a year and we'll make it happen last year. Well, you know what happened last year, don't you? Like the entire world decided to shut down. And so nobody was going anywhere. So we called back again and we said, could we possibly move it forward one more year? And they said, yeah, we'll move it forward one more year for you. So everybody has been gracious. So on our 37th wedding anniversary, we're going to celebrate our 35th wedding anniversary back where our whole marriage started on the island of Hawaii. And I think it's going to be a wonderful time. Linda and I are excited about it. And I am excited about watching this Christmas series on the beach while y'all are here with your coats on. That's what I am excited about. Several things have happened over the life of this church. It seems like it was just 12 years ago that I met a guy named Trent Forrest. He was working as an intern in the student ministry department of the church of which we were a part of that helped plant us. And when I came to him and said, you know what? What we thought initially we were only going to miss 2 weeks because of the change this year and then our last year and then the change up to this year, the airlines have made it where we can't leave on the time that we were. So while it's still 2 weeks, it happens over 3 weekends. So I said, would you be like up to preaching for three weekends in September? I mean, in December. And he comes back and says, oh, could I do four? And I was like, yeah, you could do. I'm up for that. If you're up for that, I'll do four. And so Trent Forrest is going to bring us our entire Christmas series. And I wanted him to come up here on stage with me for just a moment. You know, 12 years ago when we just started, I was trying to figure out how to go from being an accountant to being a pastor. And Trent was trying to figure out the world of student ministry and what that looks like. And we have been together for 12 years now doing this thing called ministry. There have been ups and downs, and there have been so many good times. And I told the other two services that over the past 12 years, I feel like we become like one of these old married couples, and we don't even have to talk. Sometimes we just look at each other and we
stress the same, you know.
And we know what each other we're kind of thinking just by the look and the things that go on. And I want to thank you just for the way you have given, for the way you have made Northfield the church family it is, for the way that you have supported not only myself, but the way you have supported Trent and our whole staff. And I want to thank you for the way that I know you're going to support one young man that I think is one of the finest young men in Christian ministry today. And so he is going to begin today. He's going to lead us through the entire Christmas season this year. I'm looking forward to being a part of that and just watching as we grow under his leadership and development this season. And I want to begin that by praying for you. Father, I thank you. I thank you for bringing us friends on this earth that we can do life together with, and Father, that we can do ministry together with. I thank you for the ways that you have grown each of us. And Father, I thank you for the ways that you have used us in your kingdom. I pray for many more of those together. Father, right now in this season, I thank you for Trent. I thank you for the way that you have prepared and equipped him over the last 12 years for this moment. Father, and I pray that you will grant him wisdom, that you will you grant him that measure of your Holy Spirit, that when he speaks, it is straight from your heart out of his mouth to each of our ears. I pray that you will do in us what you did in Acts chapter 2, and that you will allow us to hear what we need to hear, Father, to live for you and in this world and to make a difference. I thank you for him. I thank you for blessing not only my family's life, but Father, for blessing the life of our church family through Trent and his wife Haley and their children. And I lift him up to you, Father, for just a time as this. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen. Hey.
Thank you, Trenton.
Hey, before you go, I want to say thank you to you. This is an incredible opportunity to lead throughout this Christmas season. But I look and I see Kevin sitting over here who's played so much into who we are and where we are now and to you. And just to thank you for the sacrifice and the ways that you have led us over these last 12 years as well. And so I hope that this time that you get away is a restful time. He didn't even tell you this service, but he's running a marathon while he's gone. And this is like, it's an incredible feat because we all have watched the way that 2 years ago he battled cancer, just stared it right down in the face and faithfully walked through that. And I'm thankful that through anything that comes your way, you walk through that in a faithful way that is God honoring, but is an example to each of us. And so I look up to you in so many ways. I'm thankful. Just that you're going to get away, that you're going to rest, and that you and Linda are going to get some time. And so I want to say thank you to you as well. Okay. So thank you, let me pray for you. Okay. Let me pray for you. Father, I'm thankful for this man and the ways that you have equipped him for really what you've called him to in this life. The accounting was just a background, but you've taken that and you've been able to use that and you've been able to mold and to develop who I think is one of the best church leaders in the world. And so God, I'm thankful that we get to watch that firsthand. I'm praying for his time, that he gets to get away and to have rest for him and for Linda, that they would go away and they would be like a young married couple again, that spending time on the beach and laughing together. God, I pray that it rejuvenates him in such a way that when we get to celebrate the next 12 years together, that he is restful and that he is a part of what is going on. So, Father, I'm thankful for Tom, thankful for this church that we get to serve faithfully with you. God, we love you and we say amen.
Amen. Thank you. Hey. Thank you, guys.
Hey, guys. All right. Well, hey, yeah, give it up for Tom. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. So, we are jumping into week one of this series that we are calling Countdown to Christmas. And so now that Thanksgiving is officially behind us, we can jump into the Christmas season. I know there's some purists out there that are like, no Christmas before Thanksgiving, and that's okay. I was once there as well, but 2020 took away that angst, took Christmas before Thanksgiving for me. I'm like, I'm in. Like, if we're just going to celebrate Christmas, like, let's go for it and let's jump in. And so I'm excited for this season, but now all the rest of you are catching up as well. I'm glad that we can jump in as well. So a little crowd participation for you as we jump in. I want to know, how prepared are you for Christmas this year? So on a count of three, I'm going to give you on a scale of 1 to 10. Okay, hit me anywhere in that. Scale of 1 to 10, how ready for Christmas are you? Here we go. 1, 2, 3. I heard some tens from very young voices. I heard some sixes from a few. I heard some ones. That was like you got a few more days to get ready there. But in this, I think a lot of us, we do the same thing. That when it comes to this moment of, are we prepared for Christmas? The list that comes from are we prepared is a very physical list, right? I would say that it comes from a very common list that we all go through. And you tell me where you are on this. Let me ask, is the tree out of storage? Anybody? A few of you got that out there. Yeah. Is the tree standing? Right? Because you go through that phase where like the box comes out, but the tree may not go up. It's just like step at a time. I get that. How many of you ever got the tree out, you got it standing, and then you remember towards the end of last year it started to develop a little bit of a lean, and now you're like, oh, I forgot about that lean. And then how many of you have had to go buy a new tree this year? Anybody? Yep, there you go. I did get a text after one of our services that somebody said, fake tree, fake Christmas. And so some of you are real tree folks out there. There you go. I got a few. That's fine. It, you know, if you don't have a real tree, you still have a real Christmas. Okay, I promise. It'll be okay. But let me ask this. Is the tree decorated? Yeah? Yeah. There you go. Got a few. Is the house decorated? Because it's not just the tree, right? You got the staircase. You got the fireplace. You got all. Is the house decorated? I heard less yeses than I did on the tree. Has the elf shown up on the shelf yet? Did he show up? Yeah. Ours showed up yesterday. He's just hanging out from our fan in the living room, just watching everything there. Let me ask this. Let's take the big shift here. Have the gifts been bought? More accurately, have the gifts been ordered from Amazon? Yeah, that's it. Have you checked the status of your shipping? Did you go 2 hours later and check it again? Anybody? And then you saw it shipped, and then you check 2 hours later to see, ooh, where has it gone? Amazon's like, dude, chill. Like, it's going to get there when it gets there. You'll be all right and be good. Have the gifts arrived? There were no yeses on that one. There we go. I take it, then that means that the gifts have not been wrapped yet. But as we do this, as we count down to Christmas, our level of preparation tends to become our focus for the next 26 days, 12 hours in just under 15 minutes, as that is our official countdown to December the 25th. And we prepare by making room in our homes for the tree. We rearrange the mantle. We hang up all of our holiday cards on the door, on the fridge. And we prepare our home in such a way that helps this arrival of the Christmas season to come in. We'll prepare shopping lists for friends, for families. We'll prepare grocery lists for all of our favorite Christmas treats. We'll prepare our living rooms or our movie rooms as we settle in and hang out with our favorite characters like Buddy the Elf and Clarence the Guardian Angel and John McClane, if you're so inclined, to my diehard loving friends that are in the room. But I don't want you to hear me wrong on what I'm about to say, because I love this season. It is without a doubt my favorite time of the year. I enjoy this moment of anticipation that comes with Christmas. I remember what it's like as a kid to be giddy, and I'm seeing it now through the eyes of my three-year-old as he's getting excited about this Christmas season. But don't miss this, because if the preparation of Christmas becomes our sole focus this season, then we have missed something. That if our preparation becomes our sole focus for what is happening within these next few weeks of our lives, then we are missing something. Because our goal should be, over the course of this season, is to prepare not only our homes, but to prepare our hearts for what God is about to do right here within our midst. Yes, the home should be decorated. Yes, the homes are going to look immaculate and we're going to have family gatherings and it's going to be wonderful. But if just the home is the only thing that we're focused on and we miss out on preparing our hearts and tuning our hearts to what God is going to do right here within our midst, then we are missing something. Because as we know, in this countdown season, this season of Advent, or this season of the arrival of Jesus, there's an excitement to that. There's a level of fun that comes with that, and there's something about this season that I think our heart longs for. You guys remember that feeling when you were a kid, and it's kind of stayed with you as you've gotten older, and I don't know, for some of you, that some of that joy kind of may have been scaled back a little bit as you've grown, but there's still something about this season that we long for, that we love. And we chalk it up to, it's Christmas magic, right? It's just that Christmas spirit. But I think it goes even deeper than that. I think this season is more than just the lights. It's more than just the movies. It's definitely worth more than just the music. But I think there's something about this season that's been placed deep within our hearts that we long for it. I think back, as you look at the words of King Solomon, what many attribute him to have written in Ecclesiastes 3, says this, that God has hidden eternity into the hearts of mankind. That he has placed that within us, that although we may not be able to fathom what God is fully up to right here and right now within our midst, although we may not be able to really comprehend and put our finger on from beginning to end everything that God is up to, there is still something within our hearts that has been wired in such a way that it pines for the eternal. That here and now doesn't become enough for us, that we think there's more to this. I think that's why in this Christmas season, it's not just about the marketing ploys. It's not just about the peppermint mochas, even though I love those. It's not just about those things that we experience that are enough for us. But that deep within us, God has wired us to long for the cries that I think come with this season. Because with this season, we take a closer look at what God is doing. And what you have probably seen is those around you who throughout the rest of the year don't normally seek out the presence of God in their life, that in this season, they'll take a second look. They'll wonder, there's something about this. There's something going on in this season that I want to experience, that I want more. Because there is a sense of joy, there is a sense of cheer that comes, but let me tell you, it's not Santa that gets the joy. That I think there's something within us that longs to see what God has been up to. And let me tell you, we're not the only ones that have this longing and this sense of anticipation. We're going to take a little stroll through memory lane as we're going to look at a few key scriptures along the way of realizing that we are not the only generation that has been longing for or anticipating this advent or this arrival of Jesus. Let's go back to Genesis chapter 22. This is God. He's talking to Abraham. And he gives them this promise because he declares, Abraham, you're going to be the father of a great nation. That you are going to have not just one child, but you're going to have a whole line of children that come from you and a whole nation really that is going to come from you. And God says this. He says, I will surely bless you. And I will surely multiply your offspring as the stars of heaven and as the sand that's on the seashore. This is like uncountable. And he says, in your offspring, they shall possess the gate of his enemies. And you might look at that and think in earthly terms that, yes, this nation that he's going to build is going to come and they're going to be able to conquer those enemies. But you have to look deeper in this because this is a direct revelation of God talking about his son Jesus, that he is going to be reigning victory over those that stand in the way. But then he continues, he says this, and he says, and in your offspring shall all the nations of the earth be blessed. It's kind of this little hint, this little moment, this little whisper in this promise of God that something is coming from you, Abraham. Something is coming that's going to change this world. And it continues. This is in Numbers chapter 24. This is Balaam. He says this. He says, I see him, but not now. I behold him, but not near. That a star shall come out of Jacob, Jacob being that next son that will come in this family line, who's later would be named Israel, that will come out of Jacob, that a scepter will rise out of Israel. And you gotta look, this is kingdom language here. That again, it's that whisper that Balaam says, there's something that is coming. I can't see it, I can't put my hands on it, but there's something that is coming. And then it continues, the prophet Isaiah says this in chapter 7, verse 14, says, behold, this is a sign. The virgin shall conceive. And this is where like the Christmas alarm goes off, right? You're like, ooh, that sounds familiar, right? I know this story. This is something to look for. That the virgin shall conceive and bear a son and call his name what? There you go. Many of you are listening. But call his name what? Emmanuel. And if you're a student of scripture, you know this word that means what? Yeah, God with us. So again, the sign to look for. The prophet Isaiah continues, says this in chapter 11. It says, there shall come forth a shoot from the stump of Jesse. This is again that same line that came from Abraham, that came from David. It's in that same line, from the stump of Jesse. And a branch from his roots shall bear fruit. And notice what this fruit, and you tell me if this sounds familiar and who this is talking about. It says that the Spirit of the Lord shall be upon him. And it continues that he'll have the spirit of wisdom and understanding, the spirit of counsel and might, the spirit of knowledge and a fear of the Lord. Again, like this is like the Jesus siren going off. Then look at this in Micah. It says, but you, O Bethlehem, and again, this is where, again, that Christmas radar is going off. Like something happens in Bethlehem. This is a big moment. But you, O Bethlehem, you're too little to be among the clans of Judah. For from you shall come forth one who is to be ruler in Israel. And you think again, like, okay, in human terms, there's going to be a king that comes from this area. But no, this is bigger than just a king over Israel. This would be even larger than that. But again, it's that radar. It's like boop, 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 something here. Who's going to be a ruler in Israel? Who's coming forth is, just as we are experiencing now, who is from old and from ancient days, that has been called upon, who has been talked about, who has been anticipated, that he is coming, that something is coming. And then in Malachi, check this out. This is talking about John the Baptist. And this, again, as we talk about preparing the way, you're going to see this moment happen in this Christmas story as well. Or after Jesus' birth, you'll see John the Baptist go before. And he says, behold, I will send my messenger, and he'll prepare the way before me. And the Lord whom you seek, right? The Lord whom you seek will suddenly come to his temple. And he continues, he says, and the messenger of the covenant in whom you delight, behold, he is what? He's coming. Something is happening. It's coming. And this is what we've been anticipating. We've been waiting for this. We've been longing for this. There's something within our hearts that is just being pulled towards this and pulled towards this and pulled towards this. And we can't explain it. Oh, but we long for it. We desire it in such a way that we can't always comprehend. And they would wait for what God would do. Year after year, decade after decade, century after century, even two millennia go by. And as there's this longing and there's this anticipation and there's these prophets that speak this word of God, and then all of a sudden there's 400 years of nothing. We're waiting. And where it looks like God was silent, God was silently at work, waiting for just the right time. And to kick off this all-too-familiar Christmas season, I want to kick off with an all-too-familiar Christmas reading from Luke chapter 2. It says this: "In those days, Caesar Augustus issued a decree that a census should be taken of the entire Roman world. This was the first census that took place while Quirinius was governor of Syria. And everyone went to their own town to register. And Joseph also went up to the town of Nazareth in Galilee, to Judea, to Bethlehem." Remember the Christmas radar? "To Bethlehem, the town of David, because he belonged to the line and to the house of David." Again, Christmas radar, Christmas radar, Christmas radar. "He went there to register with Mary, who was pledged to be married to him, and she was expecting a child. And while they were there, the time came for the baby to be born, and she gave birth to her firstborn, a son. She wrapped him in cloths and placed him in a manger because there was no guest room available for them. And there were shepherds living out in the fields nearby, keeping watch over their flocks at night. And an angel of the Lord appeared to them, and the glory of the Lord shone around them. They were terrified. But the angel said to them, 'Do not be afraid. I bring you good news. Good news that will cause great joy for all the people. For today, in the town of David, a Savior has been born to you. He is the Messiah, the Lord. And this will be the sign for you, that you will find a baby wrapped in cloths and lying in a manger.' And suddenly, a great company of the heavenly host appeared with the angel, praising God and saying, 'Glory to God in the highest heaven, and on earth peace to those whom his favor rests.' And when the angels had left them and gone into the heaven, the shepherds said to one another," like anybody would in this situation, they said, Let's go to Bethlehem and see this thing that has happened, which the Lord has told us about." And so they hurried off, and they found Mary and Joseph and the baby who was lying in the manger. And when they had seen him, they spread the word concerning what had been told to them about this child. And all who heard about it were amazed at what the shepherds said to them. And Mary treasured up all these things and pondered them in her heart. And the shepherds returned, glorifying and praising God for all they had heard and seen, just as it had been told to them." You see, this moment of Scripture, it is a beautiful culmination of promises made and promises kept. The one who has been foretold about, the one who has been prophesied about, the one whom their hearts longed for and they heard about generation after generation after generation. Well, guess what? You're not just hearing about him, you're seeing him firsthand. And so I love, like, the shepherds, what they did in verse 16. It says they hurried off and they went and found. And what did they find? Yeah, they found Mary and Joseph, but that's not who they were looking for. Who did they find? They found who? They found the baby. And where did they find the baby? I know, it's like Clue. It's like Colonel Mustard in the dining room with the candlestick, right? It's just like, this is what I'm looking for. This is who did it. This is what's happened. So they hurried off and they found it. Just like it had been told to them. Just like it had been foretold to them. That who they would find is they would find the baby, and they would find him wrapped in swaddling cloths. It happened. It happened. This is what we celebrate in this season. It happened. Promise made. Promise kept. But let me tell you, if that is all that this season calls our attention to, then again, I think we have missed. Don't get me wrong. The Christmas story, it is worth our celebrating, and it is worth our remembering, but the Christmas story can't just end like that. The story of Jesus goes on, because this baby who was born didn't stay a baby. Those of you who have kids, you know this, babies don't stay babies. But this baby, Jesus, would grow up. And the prophet Isaiah would write this about this baby, Jesus: that he grew up before him like a young plant and like a root out of dry ground. He had no form or majesty that we should look at him, and no beauty that we should desire him. He was despised and rejected by men, a man of sorrows, and acquainted with grief. He would bear our griefs and carry our sorrows. He was pierced for our transgressions and crushed for our iniquities. And upon him was the punishment that would bring us peace. You see, thankfully, the climax of the story isn't that a baby was born, but nor is the climax of the story that this baby would grow to die, because you see, many men have been born and grown and died. But the climax of the story is actually found a little bit later, because the story of this Jesus, this baby Jesus who was born under the law, born of a virgin, born as he was prophesied and told about this baby, he would grow up and he would live in such a way that he was perfect and without sin and without blame. And yet this Jesus would humble himself and he would submit himself to a death on a cross on our behalf, to carry our grief, our transgressions, our iniquities. And this baby Jesus that would grow up and that would submit himself to death, he would do, and he would be placed where all dead men are placed, and he would be placed in a tomb. And oh my goodness, thankfully that is not the end of the story either, because then this baby Jesus who grew up as this perfect Jesus, who died as our Savior Jesus, was placed in a tomb, and then he would breathe again like a came back to life Jesus. That he would breathe again, that he would talk again, that he would walk again, that he would teach again, that he would eat again, that he would do all the things that alive men do again. Because you know why? Because this Jesus was alive again. That is the climax of this Jesus story. That this moment in history that changed everything is changed with this resurrection of Jesus. And then something even more incredible happens. That not only was this Jesus born, lived perfectly, submits himself to death, placed in a tomb, but then comes back to life, but then in this resurrected state, Jesus then, he takes this mission of what he was going to call the church, and what we know is today, and he would take it and he would hand it to his disciples. He said, look, I did the heavy lifting. I did the whole salvation front thing, like everything. I took care of this. And so now you have a job. You have a job. You have a duty. Go take this, spread this. Many of this we're still doing today, because as you see in the end of Luke, that great commission moment, Jesus says, look, I'm leaving, but there is one that is coming, one that is going to be even better than if I was here with you. I am leaving, but this is what is coming, and this is the mission that you are to take, and you are to fulfill in the world around you. Go and do this. And then I love this moment that happens in the book of Acts as Luke continues the story in Acts. This is in Acts chapter 1. It says, so when they came together, in this resurrected state, in this resurrected form, they're seeing Jesus. When they came together, one of them asked, Lord, is this the time that you're going to restore the kingdom of Israel? To which Jesus is probably like, dude, no, like you're missing it. We're not talking about that right now. This is bigger than this. This is all nations, all people. This is what is happening. But Jesus says, look, that's not for you. It's not for you to know the times or the seasons that the Father's fixed by his own authority. But this is what you need to worry about. This is what you should be concerned with right now, that you will receive power when the Holy Spirit has come upon you, and you will be my witnesses in Jerusalem and in all Judea and Samaria and to the end of the earth. This is your job. This is your focus. This is what you need to be working on right here and right now, that you will receive the power that the Holy Spirit has. And this is still what we're fulfilling. You see this through this campaign that we're going through, that we're looking to raise money, not just so that we can raise money, but so that we can make the name of Jesus known in what is our Jerusalem and Judea and Samaria and the ends of the earth, so that we can continue to fulfill this mission that Jesus has placed into the hands of humanity. But then the story continues, because in verse 9 it says that when he had said these things, as they were looking on, he was lifted up and a cloud took him out of their sight. That just like, boom, like Jesus like, Seacrest out, right? They're just gone. And they're gazing into the heavens, because like they're just watching him, and they're gazing off into the heavens, and then Jesus just leaves. And then I love, it says, behold, two men show up in white robes, and they're looking at him like, what are y'all doing? They're just standing here looking into heaven. It says like, what are y'all doing? Sorry, you can go to verse 11 now. That was my bad. It says, men of Galilee, like, why do you stand looking into heaven? Why are you just standing here looking off into space? Says this Jesus, he knew, and that's a tell. They knew what was happening here. They're not just like calling him out for looking up into the sky. He says, this Jesus, who you just saw taken up into heaven, he will come back. He will come in the same way as you saw him go into heaven. He's going to come in the same way that you saw him go. This Jesus will come in the same way as you saw him go into heaven. You see, before where we saw promise made and then promise kept, we're seeing right here, humanity has been put on notice. Promise made. This Jesus whom you saw go, he will come back. The same way that you saw him go, this Jesus will come back. Which means, I think, we have to ask the question, how do we respond? How do we respond to this reality, to this promise that has been put in front of us about this risen and this resurrected Jesus? What do we do now? Because I think it's similar to how those early disciples of Jesus modeled. That our goal is not to just sit back and talk about what it was like when God was here. The disciples could have done that, but they would have missed out on fulfilling this mission that God has put in front of them. Our goal is not to sit back and just ponder and go, man, if Jesus was still here, if God was still here, if God were among us now. It's not to look back at what God has done, but it's to live into this command and this promise into what Jesus has said he was going to do. Promise has been made, promise has yet to be kept, but we don't live in such a way. We live in such a way that is hopeful in what God has done, what he is going to do, and what he will do. This becomes our job. And let me tell you, you think the end of the story right there is a great story? I haven't even gotten to the best part. Because where humanity was put on notice in Acts chapter 1, where this Jesus will come in the same way that you saw him go, promise made, John gives us a glimpse at the promise being kept. And this is what he says in Revelation 21. And I heard a loud voice from the throne saying, behold, the dwelling place of God is with, that was your part, behold, the dwelling place of God is with, he will dwell with them, and they will be his people, and God himself will be with as their God. He continues, says that he will wipe away every tear from their eyes, and death shall be no more. Neither shall there be mourning, nor crying, nor pain anymore, for the former things have passed away. And he who was seated on the throne, let's quick recap here, who is this? One more time, he who was seated on the throne, who is that? One more time, he who was seated on the throne is who? Don't forget that. That he who was seated on the throne said, behold, I am making all things new. And then he said, write this down. Write this down because these words are trustworthy and true. Promise made, promise kept. You see, for us as followers of Jesus, as we are in this mode of counting down the days to Christmas, we don't just count down the days to look back at what God has done, but the season is designed to posture us in such a way that we look back at what God has promised, we look back at what God has done, and in doing so, it gives us this hope that as we look ahead at what God is going to do, we can be reminded that we are people of promise as well. That our God is coming back. And so in doing so, the question that I ask this morning is this, is what does it look like to live between the two Advents? What does it look like to live between the two arrivals? The arrival of Jesus that we celebrate over 2 millennia ago, but then also the arrival that is to come one day. What does it look like for us to live between the two Advents? I think back to the moment that Haley and I found out we're going to be parents. And those of you who've had kids, you know what that process is like of, like, you have that, like, uh-oh moment where you're like, is this real? this is happening. And then, over the course of the next 9 months, really 6 months, because the first 3 months you're kind of in shock and you're like, is this really going to happen? I was just like, I'm not like, no. And then like the bump happens and you're like, it's real. You know what I'm saying? Like you have that moment. But you begin to do all of the changes to your home. Like, we gave our kid its own room. We built this bed. Well, we didn't build the bed. We assembled the bed. And we began to change our home in such a way that prepares for the arrival of this new addition to our family. Because let's be honest, if we didn't do anything knowing, hey, a baby's coming, if we didn't do anything, you guys would look at us like we were completely nonsensical and we were absolutely crazy, because why would you live in such a way when you know that something is coming? And I think through that process, that it wasn't just our homes that we prepared for the arrival of our baby, and I look at sweet baby Elle, that it wasn't just our home that we prepared for the arrival of our children, but there was something in that process that prepared our hearts as well. That at the very core of our identity and who we were, that we were no longer Forrest family of two, but we became Forrest family of three. Now, Forrest family of four. That the very core of our identity shifts. And your heart prepares in such a way for that anticipation of the arrival of this thing into your world. So my question is this. Is as we enter into this Christmas season, as we count down to Christmas and the arrival that we celebrate of our Savior over 2,000 years ago, can we do so in such a way that it begins to mold and it begins to shape and it begins to change the way we live here and now in anticipation of Him coming back? Over the next few weeks, we're going to zoom in on the life of that Jesus. And we're going to look at His habits, and we're going to look at His postures, and we're going to look at His routine, and we're going to look and answer some ways that I think Jesus instructs us and gives us example of how it is we are to live between these two Advent moments. So, that sound like fun? That sound exciting to you? I hope it is, because it is for me. And so, to close down today, I have two challenges for you. Two challenges that on the surface are not going to make sense, but I promise, just stick with me. Challenge number one is this. Everywhere you go this week, drive the speed limit. And some of you are like, drive the speed limit? What do you mean? Drive the speed limit. Notice what it is and drive the speed limit. Catch yourself. Watch yourself. Drive the speed limit. And the second is this, and you think, oh, if driving the speed limit's hard, then this next one's going to hurt. But two times this week, not once, two times this week, I want you to intentionally seek and find 15 minutes of silence and solitude. 15 minutes. And I say intentionally seek because this world is not going to give you 15 minutes of silence or solitude. You will have to go seek it, and you will have to find it in that way. But two times this week, practice that discipline of silence and solitude and slow down. Let me pray for you guys, and then we'll wrap up. Father, Father, we're thankful for this time of year. We're thankful for the way that you have wired us to be drawn to what you are up to in this world. And it is incredibly humbling, and it is incredibly honoring that you would have placed the mission of your church into the hands of humanity. And so, God, would you allow us to go forth from here and throughout this entire Christmas season, that those who may be looking at you for the first time, that even though they may see us, God, I pray that they don't see us, but they see your very presence through us during this time of year. God, would you allow this time of Advent to prepare our hearts in such a way for not just what you have done, but for what you will do on this earth. God, we ask that your kingdom come and your will be done on earth like it is where you are. We love you, and we all say together, amen. hey, before you go, don't forget, if you want to be a part of our exciting events going on with either Jesus Birthday Bash or the viewing of the star, go to northfieldchurch.net/events. If you're on our app, you can find it on the events tab. It's on our website. Go check that out. I hope that you guys are excited about this Christmas season. We're going to dive in next week to part two of Countdown to Christmas. I hope that you'll plan on joining us and inviting a friend to come with you. Y'all have a great rest of your weekend. Peace.